Welcome to one more edition of Politics Unwrapped. I'm Egberto Willis, your host. We're here with Dr. Cynthia Miller Idris. Dr. Idris is professor of sociology and education at the American University in Washington, D.C., where she directs the polarization and extremism research and innovation lab called PERIL, great initials, in the Center of University Excellence. She is previous author of The Extreme Gone Mainstream, Commercialization and Far-Right Youth Culture in Germany, and Blood and Culture, Youth Right-Wing Extremism and Belonging in Contemporary Germany. Well, have we brought Germany to America? Dr. Miller Idris, welcome to Politics Done Right.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. First of all, you just wrote a new book, Hate in the Homeland, the Global Far Right. It's a silly question, given our times. Why did you write the book?
It's not a silly question. It's a great question. I mean, and it's a great question, not just because of what's going on at the moment, but it evolved out of, you know, having finished that previous book that you just mentioned called The Extreme Gone Mainstream, which was really about what was happening in Germany and Europe and was based on almost 10 years of research, including ethnography on the ground and a long project working with photographers. So an image database of how commercialization had, how clothing had changed, style had changed, looking at protests across the country. And I wrote that. And as I turned it in 2 months later, Charlottesville happened. And so, you know, here I was based in the US, and then you have this mainstreaming and normalization show up here, followed by several episodes of extreme violence globally and in the US that introduced me to a lot of conversations in the US that I had not been a part of previously, because I think people thought, even I myself thought, I was primarily a scholar of sort of fringe subcultures in another country rather than an expert on what was happening in the US. And I think that seeing how the European changes in the European youth extremist scene had arrived in the US and what was happening here to kind of modernize the far right movement and white supremacist extremism, meant that I suddenly had an audience of people here who wanted to know about these kinds of things. So I was asked to, you know, testify before Congress and brief, you know, I mean, I'm suddenly in meetings with policymakers that I'd never been a part of before. And so I thought there was a lot happening in those conversations that was missing some of what might be a more effective at addressing interventions in addressing far-right extremism even before it began, sort of at the very early intervention stage. And so I wrote the book both to explain to a broader American public what I thought was happening, and also to try to change the agenda or set a new agenda for how we might intervene at earlier stages and understand where the mainstreaming is happening.
Now look, for some time in this country, we have known that the far-right, the terrorism in this country, more so than Islamic or otherwise, was coming from that fringe. We knew it. It's not a new thing. We knew it before 2016. We knew it before 2012. The FBI was all on it. They've had their they've had their infiltrators in these organizations. Why is it that it took the actual, well, I don't even want to say the actual issue of violence, because they have already brought down a building in Oklahoma. Why is it that we took so long to see this as a real problem in America?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of reasons why. One of which is just, you know, how hard it is for Americans to recognize extremist ideas if they don't come in a package that fits the idea that they have in their head of what a white
explain
supremacist
that
extremist,
is that
right?
Is so, that is a very important statement, and I'd like you to articulate it in words, because a lot of times people jump around the subject as to why. So please tell me why in your eyes.
So I think most Americans think, you know, if you have white supremacist ideas, you must have a swastika tattoo on your head, or, you know, you're with out in a backwoods militia, and that this, so when they saw these guys walking across a college campus and, you know, mainstream University of Virginia campus with khakis and polo shirts, it was a aesthetic shock, right? I mean, that's the kind of, like, people have a hard time recognizing the ideas, white people in particular, have a hard time recognizing ideas as extreme if they don't come into in a package that, you know, if they come in a package that's more like the kid next door than the neo-Nazi of their imaginations. And so I think, you know, that's part of it, is that there was this mainstreaming and normalization going on. And so you're seeing it seep into the mainstream at the same time as we also had rising numbers of hate groups. You know, that explosion started after Obama was elected. So you really see this dating back to reaction to the first African-American president getting elected, and then the normalization and mainstream coming later. So I think it's from the fringe into the mainstream, then the normalization and mainstreaming happens. We see it in Charlottesville, and then we start seeing, you know, real upticks in violence that finally drew the attention of people like Congress and Department of Homeland Security to finally issue a report just this year that finally says the most lethal threat facing the nation is from white supremacist extremists. So even if people knew it, you know, and then of course 9/11, right, is looming large in people's heads, and, you know, the entire infrastructure that was built around it, including the Department of Homeland Security itself, yeah, right, which was created in reaction to 9/11. So you have this entire infrastructure that's built and is telling stories to American people about the ways to keep them safe as being about foreign terrorists, you know, Islamist terrorists, like overseas in some place, who are going to infiltrate and infect, you know, homegrown extremism, all the while homegrown extremists that are bubbling up, you know, from within this country are basically being not totally ignored, because I think you're right, the FBI has been doing, you know, all along has been infiltrating these groups in ways that is, you know, often not acknowledged, and that we rely on when you look at the number of foiled plots every single year. And every year on the far right fringe, you know, back all the way back to 1949, on average, the vast majority of far right extremist violence comes from the white supremacist fringe. So we know that, and that was true last year as well, even though the anti-government side is growing. But I think a lot of what we see happening is harder for people to recognize, you know, getting back to that kind of package idea. If it comes in a suit, or it comes in a, you know, a clean aesthetic package, and not in the kind of, it couldn't be someone they know, because they would recognize it, right? I think that's the part that's been more recently acknowledged.
Let's look at something like I think it was the Wisconsin legislature being taken over by gun-touting, AR-15-touting people, and a Black Lives Matter a march outside. You ask a certain percentage, there's a large percentage of this population that looks at people in the Black Lives Matter as somehow a terrorist organization, and somehow seeing people with guns in these legislatures as okay. What's the psychology, what is the pathology, I should say, behind that thought process? And again, in your studies, as somebody who's actually studying this on the ground, how do we fix that pathology? Because armed, not armed, I mean, how do you fix that?
Well, some of it is, you know, political rhetoric that from not just elected officials, but law enforcement, local sheriffs, you know, who position those armed individuals, whether they're vigilantes or local militia groups, as either as heroes, sometimes actually using language of heroes that valorize individual action coming into the streets in that way, particularly when they're there to protect the status quo, right? So some of these folks who come out to protect law enforcement or to sort of support, the local authorities. And then you have incendiary language against peaceful protesters, calling them riots, calling, vigilante group calls to come out and protect the city against evil thugs, right? So you have these kind of dog whistle racist ideas that come across that way as well. So I think some of it is the rhetoric that's out there that circulates, that shapes the way that people think and the way that people are positioning it, the media coverage, depending on what, you know, it's so politicized, right? This kind of like how you frame it. And then a lot of it is just sits in this idea about like these American ideas about freedom and tyranny and liberty, and all the way that the anti-government fringe, the anti-government extremist fringe, positions their arguments as about individual rights against some kind of oppressive regime. And somehow that that language, right, when coming across from these militia groups, although you can have in the Black Lives Matter protests also, you know, protests against oppressive regimes, against oppressive law enforcement, against police brutality. And so, and some of these scenes, there should be commonalities. And in fact, we have seen that in a couple of the protests where some of the anti-government extremists have joined forces with the Black Lives Matter protesters. But in a lot more cases, you're seeing that framing end up as politicized, as, you know, and framing the peaceful protesters as the problem rather than the ones carrying the massive arms and threatening violence.
Two things. I want to say something real quick, and that is having to do with the media. We talk about how the media actually goes ahead and presents these issues, and I have a tendency to believe that the media is, more than anything else, the media is lazy. Because what happens is you can just look at the numbers. You can take you can look at numerical analysis and figure out that this is where things are happening and that the media doesn't report that. I think that is a dereliction of duty. But if we take a look, if we go to Kenosha and we see the type of destruction and violence that occurred in Kenosha and what they're starting to find out now, I don't know if you've got the new info that showed that the person shooting at the police station was actually a right-wing extremist. The person yes. breaking glass, yeah. There's a completely difference in who caused the destruction on the day of the destruction and what we find out later.
Absolutely.
How do we get around those types of issues?
Well, some of it I think the media wants quick and, you know, not always and not all journalists to blame, mm-hmm. but a lot of media want quick and easy answers. They wanted to frame this in sort of terms that explain what's happening, right? And instead of waiting for actual investigations to come out that tell us. And so I think there is right now, seeing that this was that the armed, you know, attack on the police precinct, I think it was, is coming out, was from a far right individual or a member of the Boogaloo or someone
Boogaloo
mobilized
boys,
by
yeah.
these Boogaloo boys, right? You know, when it was blamed on the protesters, I think is a really good example of how this happens and how these blind spots in the media's coverage and the public's and, you know, public's awareness about it have to be constantly kind of called out and, you know, by folks like you right here pointing out that, but also in kind of other conversations and media coverage of it to remind people. I don't know what the solution is with this kind of media landscape that wants very quick clickbait, you know, very quick driven, where there's not as much, you know, support for journalism, funding for journalism. So they're driven a lot by ad revenue and all the kinds of things that brings in terms of how they have to. So I know there's a bigger landscape problem there and the way the media is motivated to report on stuff. But I agree with you. I think it's very problematic to have that the quick definitive things before the investigations come out.
Now, what can you tell us about, we brought up the Boogaloo Boys, that's an interesting name. What can you tell us about them and their position in the far right movement?
The Boogaloo is a really interesting case because it is, I don't call it a movement either. It's really like an organizing or a mobilizing idea. And so it's something that has both, so it's a slang term, just for listeners who might not be aware, that is a slang term that originated with a teenage prank or joke online that was a term that came to mean the second of anything, basically. And it eventually came to mean the second Civil War. And so it shows how stuff can migrate from online youth culture into offline violence. And it became embraced by these guys who use the term Boogaloo to refer to Second Civil War or a coming revolution, the idea of an overthrow of government, of a backlash against government tyranny. And it's both been organized into kind of groups and clusters of men who participate in Boogaloo type groups and actions, but also layered onto other groups. So you'll see these militia members in Michigan, for example, in that plot to kidnap the governor, not all of them, but a couple of them were sort of affiliated with Boogaloo. And so it becomes like a hashtag that gets mm-hmm. layered on to other, literally a hashtag. Like, so they're like a member of whatever militia, hashtag Boogaloo also. So it's a way of adding a call to civil war or revolution onto existing and threatening police at the same time.
Now, if you noticed, when President Obama came into power, the militia movement exploded. A lot of the white nationalists, they felt that, you know, the country is getting away from them. I don't know why, but I mean, that's what they thought. And it came to pass. Now we have Donald Trump, who seems to be their Fuhrer. My question now is, which one caused a bigger build on these guys, Obama or Trump? Because both have an influence on it.
Well, I think there's a couple things. I think what we saw is the explosion of hate groups launching, you know, really accelerating after Obama's elected. So it got to record levels. And then you have Trump's campaign rhetoric, the administration, and what that brought for the normalization and the mainstreaming of it. But on top of that, and the sort of perceived legitimation, right? The racist rhetoric, the incendiary rhetoric, the polarizing rhetoric, all of that that kind of helped mainstream and normalize and legitimate, or perceived at least as legitimizing, far-right groups, many of whom saw that as a call to action, as we saw in the first debate this fall, for example. But it's also really important to note that globally, far-right terror, right-wing terror is up 320% over the last 5 years. So this is not just an American problem. And these guys are, for the most part, you know, especially on the white supremacist fringe, extremely connected across borders, participating in an online ecosystem that is communicating, that live streams attacks, that shares, you know, bomb-making materials, that performs for each other. And you see that, you know, and I use the word perform intentionally, because you see, like, in the last two far-right extremist attacks in Germany, they either wrote their manifestos or live streamed in English, even though their native language is German. And so they were doing this not just as a, you know, white nationalist thing, but as a global white supremacist extremist attack. They really wanted this to be a global performance for others and to call others to action across borders. And so I think we have to understand what's happening in the States as part of that as well. It's definitely partly attributable to what's happening, you know, with this administration. But I also, the reason why I think that's important to understand is it's not like just one change of an administration is going to get us out of this mess. Like, this is a global problem that needs global solutions, and also something that is deeper and longer in the US than just, you know, 1 4-year, 5-year span of time.
Now, one scary thing to me is that the social cancer of racism, we all thought would be mitigated by the deaths of all the old people, all those old thoughts going away. You know, I mean, I remember one time my nephew, he looked at me and he said, "I'm going to tell you something, Tio. When you guys are all dead, things are then going to be okay." All right. That's what, and he didn't mean it on a personal nature. He meant it that when all that old cancer is extricated, it'll be all gone. Unfortunately, what I'm seeing with these types of movement is young white men are so susceptible to it. And I want to throw the question in a different way, because is it that the ascension, not the pulling down of anybody, but the ascension of others is a good tool to use to make them believe there's a birthright they're losing that they never had?
Yeah, you raise a lot of really great points in this. And so one I want to raise is that the issue of generational change. And so, you know, I think, and you also, in the very first phrase that you used, you said social cancer. And so I think, you know, this is a really important phrase, and it's one of the things I've been saying even since before the pandemic. So it's a little bit, you know, hard to use this metaphor now, but I think for a long time, we as a society, meaning we in the US, but also globally, had thought of white supremacist extremists as like a tumor or a few bad cells, whether they age out of, you know, society or can be isolated, surveilled, monitored, imprisoned, cut out from society, as long as we kept them away from everybody else, right? It's like the isolated fringe. And I think that we have to think of it instead as more like a contagious virus, which is, you know, doesn't just die out. It resurges and it comes back and it spreads online. And so it's not just a cancer that can be, bounded, you know, with getting the bad cells out, it's something that does spread, and it's, and it can spread in a new generation. And we're seeing that it spreads in this new generation online in really unusual ways and in different kinds of spaces than we'd seen before, which is what I talk about in this book, that you see it in the mixed martial arts, you see it in you know, online cooking channels and YouTube shows, you see it in lifestyle.
Help me out, you know, here, because you just scared me a bit. When you see your, when you just said you see it in martial arts and you see it in online cooking, you mean there are signs that they put even in those shows that you're...
Yeah, I mean, there are actual shows that are set up, not only like there's a German neo-Nazi vegan cooking show, right? They are using that platform to both like share recipes with people and share ideology that's racist, white supremacist, anti-immigrant. And you see that on Instagram with, you know, white supremacists, like very beautiful images that are always like aesthetically pleasing, I mean, that are like a blonde woman with a braid in a field of wheat, you know, like, and, you know, like, or with a deer in the woods or something, but that then have these messages actually explicitly written on them that, you know, or defend your people or don't mix, right? Like, so these things that say like, basically like protect whiteness. Mm-hmm. And so I think we're seeing that contagious spread, that online contagion spread in different places and spaces, which is what I try to point out in this book as like understanding how it gets mainstreamed. I had a friend tell me recently that they were looking, they were trying to do a home improvement project during the pandemic and looked up drywall like videos and, you know, ended up on this guide who does drywall. It's like a sequence of 10 videos. And so starts watching them, and by like video two or three realized the guy's starting to introduce white supremacist extremist ideas, but he's in the middle of the project. He needs to watch to the end. So he gets all the way to the end, and by the 10th video or whatever, it's full on white supremacist, you know, extremist ideology. So they've got, and you get something like that, you have a captive audience of people who are encountering it coincidentally because they're looking, you know, for a DIY project or whatever, how to unplug a drain. I mean, whatever you could be looking up on YouTube, it's a space where suddenly they can reach in their ideas out. And so by finding places that young people already spend time, right? And then getting recruiters or, you know, or just racists sharing their own ideology that way, right? It doesn't even have to be deliberate recruitment. It opens up a different way to spread that contagion.
Do you think that, to me, that almost seemed like it is pretty well financed and pretty well organized. Have you been able to find the head of this structure, or is it sort of a network based or hierarchically based or what?
Yeah, there are a lot of different groups doing this, I think. And so there are, you know, groups themselves they raise money in all different ways. They sell merchandise, they crowdsource online for activities and actions. They take donations. Sometimes they use inheritances or like wealthy, you know, money that they've raised or earned themselves. But I think most of this is not happening through groups. And that's, I think, why it's so hard for authorities and policymakers to understand it when they are pivoting from trying to understand the terrorist fringe from an Islamist extremist perspective, which is a much more hierarchical and group-based type of terrorist organization. When you look at the white supremacist extremist fringe, a lot of what happens is kind of radicalization through what we call kind of like self-radicalizing networks. People who spend time in toxic spaces online share dehumanizing racist memes, let's say misogynistic memes, and they get drawn into something that doesn't really have a head, right? Doesn't have a hierarchy, is not organized in a cell or a group. And so eventually then, if they get radicalized far enough, might start planning or plotting violence, but that's why we have these kind of lone actors enacting violence with no particular ties. And that's different than, you know, it's harder for authorities to wrap their heads around how to manage extremism if you're looking at it from the top down. And one of the things I argue in this book is, you know, we have been approaching it as like a top-down problem. What's the organization? What are the structures? How do they communicate, right? The way that the typical terrorism, you know, infrastructure mm-hmm. has been understood. Or we study from the bottom up. how are people radicalizing in their heads? What are the vulnerabilities, isolation, or, you know, anxiety or perceived precarity, or, you know, all the things that might create more vulnerabilities to white supremacist propaganda. But what I argue in the book is if you ask a different set of questions about where extremism happens by looking at these spaces and places where people encounter these ideas in the mainstream, even though they're fringe extremist ideas, then we can start to understand a sort of different way of maybe attacking it or approaching it by intervening in those places and spaces and working with experts in those like college counselors or mixed martial arts trainers or, you know, folks who understand what's going on in those scenes to begin with.
Now, in closing, I want to ask you to talk to me a little bit about COVID-19 and the influence on that and white supremacy. And the last question is, please tell me something you wish I'd asked you. And I simply didn't. So I just gave you a twofer.
Good. So the first thing is on COVID, we've seen a couple of different things. One is that obviously there's a lot more mobilization on the anti-government extremist fringe. It's been really obvious. And I think a lot of the attention on the far right has been on the anti-government side, which has its intersections with white supremacist extremism, but is also separate and in other ways, because it's not always as explicit as it is in the white supremacist extremist fringe. And so we've seen mobilization on the anti-government side. We've seen increased circulation of propaganda, a lot of anti-Asian violence, a lot of anti-Semitic hate crimes and conspiracy theories, rising conspiracy theory participation in general on the far right fringe. And then also, you know, more vulnerabilities, like I was talking about before, the extreme isolation, lack of sense of control, lack of belonging or meaningful purpose, perceived precarity, which I think is different than actual precarity, but this idea that, you know, of economic uncertainty, all of those things create vulnerabilities to rhetoric that offers scapegoats, that offers a very black and white solution to things. And so we know that it's kind of a perfect storm of, you know, increased propaganda meeting increased vulnerabilities, along with astronomical and unprecedented amounts of time online. So we just have, you know, 100 million young people across, you know, K-12 and college students, plus those who are not in college, at home, you know, online all the time, in ways that increase the chance of both child exploitation, but also, you know, exposure to propaganda and misinformation. So all of that is, you know, not great and can lead to more radicalization down the line. In terms of what I wish you'd asked that you didn't, I feel like one thing that doesn't often come up in these conversations that is starting to come up more often is the intersection of far-right extremism with misogyny and the kind of male supremacist side of things. And I think for many years, a lot of those voluntary incelibate attacks or male supremacist attacks on women had been seen as, you know, just guys with sort of personality problems, couldn't get a date or couldn't have sex or whatever. And they were lashing out and killing women in a sorority or in a yoga studio or a van attack in Toronto, you know, which have led to a lot of deaths. And I think recently there's finally a realization that the logic of male supremacy is not that different from the logic of other forms of supremacy, white supremacy, these hierarchies and the dehumanization and the attacks and the anger, and that there are also intersections. When you look at why it is that it's men engaging and men enacting in these violent ways, I hope that the coming years bring more attention to this intersection of misogyny. Why is it that the language used against that Michigan governor was so misogynistic, right? When you look at the criminal complaint, I think it's not coincidence, right? And so we see that the attack on a judge in New Jersey on her family, or the murder of Joe Cox in the UK by a right-wing extremist, that, you know, women are targets in different ways on these kinds of things, but also that there's these intersections between domestic violence, violence against women and gender-based violence, and white supremacist extremism in ways that I think haven't really been untangled enough.
I think, and because you brought up that issue, I want 30 seconds more of your time to ask you about my response to somebody today on a similar issue. And I want you to tell me if you think I got it right. A friend of mine wrote on Facebook, all the male Trump supporters I know like Trump because they get turned on by an abusive alpha male. He resembles what they desire. I would never date a MAGA for safety concerns. And my response was, women have the power to force that, but in my humble opinion, they acquiesce to the patriarchy in the church and politically. On my show, I point out that slavery and oppression no longer requires chains, and it is now inculcated in one's mind. Is that something that you can agree with, or?
Yeah, I think, I think if I understand what you're saying, it's the requirement for all, each and every one of us, is to challenge kind of the ways that we may be complicit, you know, in any structures of supremacy, including, mm-hmm. you know, including me as a white person. What are the ways that I, you know, despite trying to fight white supremacist extremism, might be missing something or might be overlooking something? What are my blind spots? And the ways that men working in these spaces trying to fight it might be overlooking some of the intersections between male supremacy and white supremacy, or domestic violence and misogyny, or, you know, the kind of role of toxic masculinity in attracting people into these kinds of macho, you know, valorization of violence and chest puffery that we see in what your friend was talking about. So yes, I agree. I mean, I think it's a constant need to be reflective, to be humble, and to be aware that there are always going to be intersections that we may not be paying sufficient attention to at any given time.
Dr. Cynthia Miller, author of Hate in the Homeland, The New Global Far Right. Thank you so kindly for having on Politics Done Right.
Thank you for having me.
We spend a lot of time deconstructing the news, trying to parse it into a form that everybody can understand. We try to find those little nitpicks where it flies above the fray, etc. If you really like these videos that we do, I want to ask a big favor. Please go ahead, number one, subscribe to our channel, and number two, please join if you can. Thank you so kindly for watching. Keep watching. Please remember to share. We must populate the entire internet with our progressive message, a message that we know is what most Americans say that they want. So help us, please, join.